sort of widely throughout Europe, always on the European Union, and in particular, always about art. His talk is going to focus on the free movement of cultural property, art objects, like the one that we see up here, and all the exceptions that member states can take to the free movement of art objects. And in his presentation, he'll be looking at jurisprudence, case law of the court, which should be familiar to us because we've looked at this free movement case law in other contexts, alcohol, the Hen and Darby case. So we've looked at that jurisprudence having to do with other types of art objects, other types of objects, goods. He's also going to look at something that is less familiar to us, which is the legislation of free movement of goods, meaning the legislative measures that are passed by the Council, Commission, the Parliament to ensure the free movement of goods. And that's something that we're going to be taking a look at in two classes. The various legislative initiatives will get a first taste here in the art context. So without any further comments, welcome, and I'll leave it to you.
Thank you a lot. Before to get into the presentation itself, I would like to make three preliminary remarks. The first will of course be dedicated to thanks Professor Biniami for his kind invitation to lecture here today in front of all of you. I am honored and delighted to do that. Second remark is I am not an English native speaker, and I think that you are probably already aware of that. And third remark, I would like to ask you, of course, not to hesitate to interrupt me at any time in order to ask me a question. So what will be the point of this talk? The point of this talk will be how movable cultural goods are protected against unlawful circulation in the European Union. As you perhaps know, traffic in works of art is the third largest illicit traffic in the world, after drugs, after weapons, and it represents something around $15 billion a year. Lawful and unlawful circulation in European Union is a very complex question because it involves different levels of legislation, domestic legislation of the member states, European Union legislation, and also international conventions. So in order to tackle this point, I will address four points. The third points will be dedicated to the member states' approach of the protection of works of art, and particularly the protection of movable property against illicit traffic. The second point will be the evolution of those domestic legislation with European legislation, and we will examine why the reason for Europe has to do something in the field of cultural property and especially movable cultural property. And this will lead us to the actual situation, that is the single market, and under the single market I will address the two remaining points, that is the export of works of art from Europe to third country. And last point, the return of cultural objects unlawfully removed from the territory of a member state. So let's begin with the first point, the member states' approaches to the protection of works of art. And I will address four sub-points. The importance of protection of works of art in Europe. Why is it so important? Second sub-point, I would like to introduce you to the very different ways that European countries tackle the problem of protection of movable cultural property. So even if you are in Europe, we have very different view on that and very different legislations. Third sub-point will be dedicated to the contradictions in one of the main approach we have in Europe related to works of art, that is a conservative approach, a search for maintaining the works of art in their country of origin. And I would like to underline how this approach sometimes is contradictory. And after that, I would like to present you very quickly international agreement in the field of protection of cultural property. That is at the end of this third point, to have a state of the art without European legislation. And after, in the second point, I will introduce you to European legislation. So, why in Europe protection of movable cultural goods is so important? Well, mainly because it is considered, works of art in Europe are considered essential to collective identities in Europe. Collective identities of our countries, for people, groups, whatever you want. And so it's a very important and sensitive question. The main example of that is that in Europe, in some countries, not all the countries, but the legislation in the field of protection of cultural goods is really, really old. And in, for example, in Italy, the first legislation appeared 5 centuries ago. Second sub-point, the different approaches that are followed in European countries in order to deal with this issue. And I will consider the two main approaches. There is an open approach and a more closed and conservative approach. The open approach is mainly the approach of northern states of Europe, broadly speaking, of course, like United Kingdom, the Netherlands, Denmark, and some other. And the main characteristic of this approach is that it is market-driven. And very few restrictions are put on the exchange of works of art, on sales, on circulation. Well, that doesn't mean that there is no concern, no a kind of public interest for that, but the main legal instruments used are private law instruments. For example, with trust and so on. The interesting point for this discussion is that with the export of works of art, this approach, market-driven approach, mean that if anybody is able to buy the work of art you want to export, you can export it freely. The only way to retain it on the territory is to buy it. So the state can do it if he has enough money. The state can find other people, donators, but this is the only way to retain the work of art. But we have in Europe a second approach of this problem. This is, as I told you, a more closed or conservative approach, of course developed in countries of Southern Europe, which are very rich of works of art, which have a very dense cultural heritage, like Spain, like Portugal, like Greece, and like Italy. And the main characteristic of this approach is that it is state-driven, with a very extensive use of public law. So I think you all know what public law is. And Public law allows public bodies, mainly the state, to unilaterally control and restrain private activities in the interest of a public interest. In all cases, the protection of cultural heritage against exportation and unlawful exportation in particular. And this interest is considered as preeminent on private interest because it is deemed as being an interest of the society as a whole. I would like to give you some example of public law provisions related to the protection of cultural goods in those countries. First example, public cultural goods, that is cultural goods belonging to the state or other public bodies, are granted a very high level of protection. Second example, public law provision strictly limit the power of disposition by owners of cultural property. And especially strictly control the exportation of movable goods. And most important example, in order to make your ideas clear, is that in all the countries like Spain, Portugal, Greece, and Italy I talked about, it is possible for the state to forbid the exportation of a works of art without any compensation. To the owner. Nevertheless, this second approach, which is very important in Europe, is contradictory, and I would like to present you two contradictions. Yes,
really quickly, just to clarify that you were still talking about the conservative approach.
Yes, I am.
They couldn't forbid the exportation without compensation. Is that correct? Did I understand that correctly?
No. The point is that the state can forbid the exportation without any compensation.
Without any compensation
to the owner.
Okay.
Yes.
So is this equivalent to taking, or does the owner retain the art, or he just can't export it? Or does the government actually pass a law and takes the art from the owner?
Ah, the thing is, if the consequence for that is the state become the owner mm-hmm. of the, it is possible. It is possible, but it's not compulsory for the state. The state can just decide to forbid the exportation, mm-hmm. to deny the authorization, and that's all.
Okay.
So it's a very incisive, very invasive instrument in the against the private property and private interest.
I think yeah. a good example would be that Raphael. You know, the Lebanon that got off.
No.
The example where the Madonna mm-hmm. of the Carnation, which the Getty wanted to purchase mm-hmm. in LA from a local family in the north of the UK, and the UK didn't have legislation that could stop the export of that Raphael, and so what they did was they put together the money that was necessary to purchase that Raphael, because they thought they had too few Raphaels, and therefore have it in the National Gallery now in London. Whereas in a country like Italy mm-hmm. or Spain, the state could simply tell that family that owned the Raphael up in the north of England somewhere, they couldn't sell it to the Getty. And of course, the value of that Raphael is much lower.
Of course.
And they can't sell it to the Getty.
Can I ask another quick question? So in the situation where there are two buyers, the state and the private party, does the state have a priority right?
In other words, if the seller
of Raphael wanted to sell it to Goethe rather than
the state has a priority, because there is another example, I cannot present you all the example of a public law provision in this field called preemption.
Okay.
That is, the state has the power to substitute to the buyer, to substitute itself to the buyer. Preemption.
So, and I think that's the case in the UK. I really don't know the UK legislation, but that's how the National Gallery was able to purchase it.
Just because he had the money.
Okay.
Just because he had the money.
Okay, so there
no,
was
no,
a
no,
right
preemption
of
doesn't exist in the UK.
Oh, okay.
Preemption doesn't
okay.
exist in the UK.
Now, even in a conservative view in the southern countries there, they couldn't forbid the sale intrastate, could they? Like within the country?
No, it's possible. Of course it's possible. Of course it's possible. You just have to inform the state of that. But you can do it.
So that they can
do it. But at this moment, at the moment of the sale, the state can use this preemption right, that is to substitute itself to the buyer.
Okay.
Okay.
But it won't, so the state will not forbid.
No, the state will not forbid the sale in itself.
Right.
But just if he's interested by the work of art, he can buy it for itself, for national collections, things like that.
Okay.
Other questions?
And this is in conservative countries.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So, the first, let's go back to the contradiction, some of the contradiction of in the conservative countries. The first contradiction that, together with the public law rules I just mentioned, a legal system of these countries includes private law rules which protect the good faith purchaser of goods, even if the goods were originally stolen. And you have many provisions in the civil law countries dedicated to that, in the Article 1153 of Italian Civil Code, Article 2279 of the French Civil Code, and Article 935 of German Civil Code. So, how concretely this approach is granted? It's granted by two elements: that the good faith is always presumed, and this comes from Roman law. And second element, ownership can be acquired through possession in good faith. You see? So, in those countries, in one hand, you have very tight public law statutes protecting works of art, but in the other hand, civil law rules enables, you know, open a margin in which trafficking of works of art can play with. The second contradiction, there are other contradictions, but I just present two of it. The second contradiction is, as you know, private international law forbids enforcement of foreign public laws. And, okay, that clear for everybody that? And the judges. Yeah, okay,
no.
I clarify.
Yeah.
Do you want to add something to that?
No,
okay.
That
is, the judges of European conservative, but also other countries, European countries, are very scrupulous in the application of this rule of private international law, which forbids the enforcement of foreign public laws. And all those statutes I taught you, I just mentioned, are public, are foreign public laws, and cannot be applied by foreign judges.
And to clarify for common law students, when one says public law, it's law that regulates relations between citizens and the state, not between two private parties. So anything that the state tells you you can't or can do with your property, like a takings, for instance, would be considered public law. So when, you know, the state tells you, grants a license to you so you can build a mall or you can alter your property, etc., that would be public law. And so that kind of law is not enforced by courts of other countries.
Well, I was just going to try to get an idea of when that would come up then. So somebody is in another country other than the country with a conservative approach, and they're being they're adjudicating in that country against the state,
mm-hmm.
because the state is trying to claim that they should have possession of the good because it was falsely
sold. It's not against
sold.
The state. It would be between... What would happen would be that the... Perhaps, I mean, if it were, for instance, it were... I'm not sure under what circumstances it would be arise. I mean, it'd be hard for the state to come to court, but somebody would be, the person who had acquired it unlawfully through some kind of unlawful export would then face another party who would be trying to get it back. You mm-hmm. know, perhaps it were stolen, for instance. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have to make. I will make
yeah,
the
okay,
distinction
so
between theft. And illicit exportation.
Well, let's continue.
Mm-hmm.
And see. Yeah.
No other question. So, the fourth sub-point is dedicated to the existing international instrument that European states, both conservative or more open, can use in order to claim restitution of unlawful removed works of art from their territories. And those legal instruments are twofold. First, you have private international law, and second, you have international conventions. both of those solutions are not very successful. That is, you are not granted a lot to have your works of art back. private international law. You have to distinguish between two cases. The first case is theft. And in case of theft, so you go before a foreign court and ask judges for ordering the return of your work of art. But problem is that, remember, many, many states have statutes of limitation, and in case of theft, they are running quite short. In case of illicit exportation, so in violation of public laws, the problem we face is the principle we previously talked about, that is, foreign judges will not enforce foreign public law, because domestic judges are in charge of enforce their domestic law, and not foreign public law, as laws, statutes on exportation, on restriction of export of works of art are. So, in both cases, under private international law, that is, when you are asking a foreign judge, you know that your work of art is another country, and you ask to the judges of these countries to order the return, is you will have not big changes for the return.
And then, and the last, this is an obvious question, I think. When in that second case, where you have illicit.
Second case, it's international convention.
No, with illicit exportation.
Illicit exportation is that.
Yeah.
The first, yes.
And what kind of situation would it be? Because I mean, the idea is. Say,
no,
I mean,
the situation would be that the works of art had be exported. From a European country to another, in violation of, let's say, the export rules of Italy,
mm-hmm.
and arriving an Italian government knows that now the works of art is in France,
oh, okay.
and asked French judges to return the object because Italian laws, it's the presence of the object on French territory, is due to a previous unlawful movement. Okay. But the French judges with answer to that, we cannot enforce foreign laws, Italian laws. We're just here to enforce French laws. You see?
Mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, The other possibility is international conventions. In this field, the main international convention is the UNESCO Convention of 1970 that circulated among you, I think. But the problem of this convention is that the field covered by it is very narrow, Article 7. That is, in this convention, there is an obligation of restitution only in the case if public museums acquired works of art belonging to public or religious foreign bodies. So it's really, really, really narrow. Let's repeat it. There is an obligation of restitution only in the case if public museums acquired works of art belonging to public or religious foreign body. Broadly speaking, because it's a little bit more complicated. So, and you know that by now, museums, and especially public museums, are working under very tight deontological rules, and they take a great care about checking the origin of what they want to acquire.
One correction. Deontologic is actually professional codes of conduct.
Okay,
so
professional codes.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
It doesn't have anything to do with conduct.
But this UNESCO convention also opened another possibility, that state parties to this convention can adopt bilateral agreements between them, going further than the provisions of the convention itself, and ensuring better standards against traffic of works of art. And the main example of that is the US-Italian agreement of 2001 that circulated amongst you. And according to this agreement, the United States engaged to forbid the entry on its territory to archaeological items coming from Italy. And of course, it disappeared. Here we have an example of this kind of archaeological items coming from Italy, and in this case it will be seized by US custom and automatically returned to Italy. We have other examples of this kind of so this is an Italy-Sicilian terracotta antifix. It's 6th century before Christus, and coming from source of Italy. Let's have some other examples.
That agreement was actually, there was a clause or something in UNESCO that said that parties to that convention could make, basically could make further agreements based upon this. Okay.
Article 9 and 15 of the UNESCO Convention.
Okay.
Is that necessary for that to be there?
That's what I was wondering. It seems a little redundant, like, because you can always make
nice statue. Great statues of Apollo also coming from south of Italy. It's around 5th century before Christus. And all of these items are subjected to
Are these things that were actually seized by US customs authorities?
Yes, these are all very nice very nice gold cup furnishing, but founded in Italy, in south of Italy.
But were these actually seized? Were these
customs
authorities? How are they brought into the United States? They're huge.
Not so huge, I think. There is perhaps, you know, if you can translate to feet, that would be useful to me, because I don't know how to translate.
About 8 inches.
No, it's not
eight and a half inches, maybe.
Yeah, it's not so big, but you know, there is a lot of ways in order to introduce that to Italy.
Really?
34 feet. about 4 feet.
Yeah, 4 inches.
Okay. And here we have other examples.
No, 13.5 centimeters.
Oh, 13.5.
Yeah, that's very nice.
Yes.
So, and this is the situation without European Union.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, just back to Brian's question. Is there something about the UNESCO Convention that required authorization to create bilateral treaties and limited it only to the state parties? Because it seems like that's something that any states could take the initiative to do on their own. So is there a special reason why that Article 9 and 15 suggestion or possibility was necessary?
No, there is no obligation for parties member to UNESCO Convention to do such bilateral instrument. You have conditions in Article 9 and 15, that is the cultural heritage of a member to the convention must be heavily threatened by illicit traffic and so on, because all the main problem, which I cannot of course tackle all the issues of this question, but the main problem is related to archaeological findings. And because archaeological findings, they are not even archaeological findings, but illicit digging. And what you found in the soil during an illicit digging, you know, state authorities don't even know that it exists. You see, don't even know that it exists. This is why this bilateral agreement between Italy and the United States is as the general aim to block the entry on the US territory of all archaeological artifacts from, I don't remember exactly the dates, but you know, from, let's say, the beginning of the arts to the 4th or 5th century before Christus.
I guess the question that I would have then, and it seems like maybe that provision is in the UNESCO Convention just almost as a catalyst, because even without
almost
the UNESCO...
As
a catalyst, maybe a spark, maybe to get the countries to think about it more, because...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Because even without the UNESCO Convention, every country is free to enter into bilateral agreements, you know, bilateral treaties. And so it seems a little bit redundant to have that clause in there. Does that...
Yeah, I mean, Article 15, is it Article 15?
Article 9 and Article 15, yeah.
Right, because Article 15 says, nothing in this convention shall prevent state parties thereto from concluding special agreements among themselves or from continuing to implement agreements already concluded regarding the restitution of cultural property removed, etc. So, before the entry into force of this convention for the states concerned. I think it's just, you know, it's almost a cautionary provision. Yeah.
It's just saying this is an exclusive.
Article 9 is perhaps more detailed. But, you know, unfortunately, I'm afraid we cannot spend too much time on that because...
Yeah.
Other question, anyway?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did I answer to you?
Yes, thank you.
So, the second point is... evolution of both legislation related to works of art, export of works of art, domestic legislation and European legislation. And I would like to tackle three sub-points. The first will be situation before the common market, the second will be situation with the common market, and the third situation with the single market. Situation before the common market it's very simple. It's the situation I described some minutes ago, so there is nothing to add. European states were totally free to regulate the circulation of works of art located on their territory to be restrictive or more open on or what they wanted to be. More interesting is the situation with the common market. So I think everybody know what is the common market. Common market mainly is a custom union. And two elements characterize a custom union. First, the prohibition of custom duties on import and exports of goods between member states. And second, the common custom tariff in their relation with third countries. And the field of the European Custom Union named common market was the trade, in all goods. So the question for us now is, the question was, are cultural goods assimilated to goods for the application of the EC treaty? At the beginning, we had no clear element of answer, but only clues. The main clues was Article 30 and its exceptions to free movement of goods. And what is the exception? You know that Article 30 provides for many exceptions to the free movement of goods, and there is one related to the imports, exports, or good that according to Article 30, member state can restrict imports, exports of goods if these goods have a national significance related with artistic, historic, or archaeological values. Just a word about the ratio of such a provision. The ratio of such a provision is that, as I already told you, cultural heritage matters are very sensitive and traditionally regulated by member states. So, ab initio, the treaty provided for an exception to the free movement of goods. In case of cultural goods. So, but for us, this was nevertheless a very interesting clue, because the interpretation of Article 30 lead to the assimilation between cultural goods to goods, because behind the exception lies the principle. And if an exception is created for some aspects of the trade regime of cultural goods, that means that the remaining aspects are submitted to the general rules of the treaty. But this was just a clue. And it's a ruling of the European Court of Justice in 1968 that made certain the assimilation between goods and cultural goods. What were the circumstances? Even after the entry into force of EC Treaty, Italy maintained a provision according to which export of cultural goods were submitted to a tax. And this approach, taxing the export of cultural goods, was heavily criticized by the Commission. And the Commission asked the court to review the Italian legislation. And the the answer of the court was twofold. First, we have a perfect syllogistic reasoning. And second, we will see the consequence of such a reasoning. So, the syllogistic reasoning was, main proposal, goods can be valuated in money. Okay. So, second proposal, cultural goods can be valuated in money and are object of trade. That's common evidence. Conclusion, cultural goods are goods. And conclusion for the case, if cultural goods are goods, all pertinent provisions of the treaty are applicable, and especially provisions related to the free movement of goods, and especially the obligation for Italy to remove all tariff barriers, and so to remove its export tax. Is that okay on this decision of the court, 1968, according to the court and consequently to European law, cultural goods are assimilated to goods and submitted to free movement, excepted the exception of Article 30 that state can use if they want. Yes?
Well, it just seems to me that that logic is incredibly flawed. I mean, human services can be evaluated as well. Does that mean humans become assimilated? According to the syllogism, that would be the case.
Yes, you're right. The purpose of the court was to answer a specific question. You know, not to deal with those broad problems, but to see if there was a justification for the Italian tax on export of works of art. And this is just part of reasoning. So of course, after that, you can reconstruct it and follow, and we can follow your approach, surely. But also, you have to see that this was just a step in order to find a very practical solution to the problem. Other question? So the conclusion of point two is that works of art are to be treated like any other goods according to EC law, and are subject to the principle of free movement of goods. However, member states retain the right to define their national heritage and to prohibit its export, but only within the exception of Article 30. And in order to enforce this, to enforce domestic legislation granted on Article 30, custom controls were made at the national custom borders. But talking about borders and internal borders within Europe, led us to the creation of the single market. And as you know, a single market is an area without internal frontiers in which the free movement of goods, persons, service, and capital is ensured in accordance with the provision of this treaty. In very few words, what is the difference between a common market and a single market? A common market was a custom union, but dealt only with the suppression of national tariff barrier. But even after the entry into force of the common market, many national non-tariff barriers were still in force. For example, national standards for food product safety and so on. So the purpose of the single market was to remove all the non-tariff barriers. And for that, to do such a removal, the treaties, EC treaty, offered two ways: harmonization or mutual recognition.
This is Article 9. Today it's 95 of the treaty, which gives the legal basis for the European institutions to act. In the past, it was Article 108.
It's Article 95?
Today,
95.
Yeah. And that's what we're going to be looking at in 2 weeks. Well, in a week's time, in two classes' time.
Harmonization means create single European legal framework. And with the effect that all national legislations in the field covered by this single European legal framework framework that existed before, the effect, the national legislation that existed before is abrogated. Mutual recognition is to make national regulations, national legislation, sorry, compatible one to each other.
Essentially, this is just to explain, because I want to bring in some of the doctrine that we've been discussing. Mutual recognition is the Cassis case. Okay? So mutual recognition was a principle that the Court of Justice introduced in the Cassis de Dijon case. Meaning, if the idea being that if a product is made lawfully in one place, then the presumption is that it should freely circulate and be used and purchased in the other place. And so that in concretely, the German government should essentially recognize the laws of France on alcohol content of liqueurs as equivalent to the laws of Germany, and hence Cassis and other alcoholics drinks freely circulate. Not alcoholics. Alcoholic beverages. This is not an argument for social dumping. So that's mutual recognition. Now that's an approach that was then used and taken by the Commission and the Council in drafting laws. Essentially they say that in any given area, the national regulation in one place is recognized as equivalent to the national regulation in another place, and hence that good or that service can be freely sold throughout the European Union, pursuant to all of these different standards. So that's essentially how mutual recognition went from the courts to the legislature. And you see why it's so powerful, because you don't have to decide one set of standards. You don't have to legislate one set of standards. You can just say...
Just, you don't have to harmonize.
Yeah, you don't have to harmonize. So that's what's important.
So we will come back on the choice between harmonization and mutual recognition later on. The main effect of the creation of a single market was the dismantling of national customs. And more precisely, the dismantling of custom control for goods moving from a member state to another. So, the risk was, once internal border abolished, the traffic of cultural goods could develop, bringing works of art from countries with strict export control to countries with more open export control, and those countries becoming an open door for export toward third countries. Is that clear for all, the mechanism? The risk, that is. So, the answer was that a risk was created by EU law, and the EU law tackled the risk, responded with another European legislation specifically aimed at the control of cultural good circulation. We have two main instruments, a preventive legislation, mainly regulation number 3911 of 1992, and second, a repressive European legislation, mainly Directive number 7 of 1993. But what I would like to stress, and that will be my conclusion on point 2, is that this European legislation was not an intended one. It is just an unpredicted consequence of free movement of goods and creation of a single market. It was not at all in the will, in the ideas of the founding father of Europe to deal about circulation of work of art. But lately, European Union has to deal with, because other European legislation endangered the circulation of works of art, making it more easy, and so open a wide margin for unlawful circulation of works of art. Is that okay?
I have one question.
Yeah.
All these licensing restrictions, or the southern countries, which have very restrictive regimes,
yeah.
Those regimes are still permitted, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then how
according to Article 13.
Right. So then how is it? So they can't tax. That was the case.
They cannot tax because
right,
Article
13
yeah,
right,
provide only for the circulation.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. So but they can
of the restrictions.
They can impose regulatory barriers. So that and then because Article 36 allows exemption. So why is it that we do get all this illicit trade then in goods? So why is it that
mm-hmm.
goods move from Florence or Sicily to London and then to and then unlawfully to the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You say that this has become a problem with the common market.
Yes, yes. I will try to answer it in the
yeah.
two following parts
okay,
of that. So I don't know if it has any sense to do break now, because
oh,
there is
okay.
just half an hour left.
Yeah, okay.
Or
yeah.
let's do a little break.
Huh? Let's do that. Yeah.
Okay. So no more than 5 minutes, please, because oh, sorry for being so.
go ahead.
We'll do this in order. It makes more sense that way.
It's automatic. So, in order to finish, so you have three instruments: international private law, the directive. But the directive only works between European members, and well, I will tell you some words about how it works, and international conventions. International conventions and the directive, they more or less they have the same objective. The only difference is that the directive works only within the Union.
Is there an international court that would deal with this?
No.
There isn't. Is
no.
So if there's a bilateral treaty or an international convention that's applicable and you are Italy making a grievance against the UK, then does the object in question belongs to a private owner? Does the UK then pay public fund restitution to Italy despite the private owner? Is the UK forced to compel the private owner to return
mm-hmm,
it? And
mm-hmm,
do they owe
mm-hmm. Yeah, I see the point. So in case of international private law, it's too chaotic in order to have clear guidelines. I can only answer your question on the basis of the directive or international convention. The trend is that in case of automatic restitution, if conditions are met, the possessor of the works of art from whom you withdraw the work of art has no right to be paid for the work of to be reimbursed, but the trend is he can be granted a compensation if he can prove, and here we have you have to distinguish according the instrument, the international instrument used, if you can prove his good faith at the moment at which he purchased the work of art, or his due diligence. The due diligence is something much more stronger that require much more than the good faith. And if he can prove that, he can be granted a compensation. Not a reimbursement, but a compensation. Okay, this is, broadly speaking, the main trend in the field.
And does the compensation come from that national's courts or from the...
From the requesting state. And the mechanism is that the requesting state has the right to take action from the person responsible from the unlawful removal of the cultural object from its territory. You know, the action of restitution, the international aspect, as a state, you go, you ask, the implementation of a convention of the directive, and it's all between the states. But afterwards, once the works of art is back, so the state can act again the person responsible for the illicit removal from this territory. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, my third point is dedicated to the Council Regulation number 3911 of the 9th of December 1982 related to the export of cultural goods to third countries. And I would like very briefly to address three sub-points. Third, the legal basis in the EC Treaty for this regulation. Second, the choice between harmonization and mutual recognition. And third, the solution adopted in by the regulation, that is partial harmonization. So first sub-point is the legal basis for this EC regulation number 3911. The legal basis was very clear and was nothing more than a consequence of the previous assimilation, cultural goods equal goods. And so the legal basis was EC Common Commercial Policy, Article 133. And there was not a big debate on that. So take care, because as a consequence of the assimilation between goods and cultural goods, all EU legislation, no, let's say, big part of EU legislation is based on cultural policy provision in the treaty, or related to provision related to the cultural policy or the creation of a single market. Okay. The choice between harmonization and mutual recognition. Harmonization would have mean the creation of an European cultural heritage notion. That is harmonization, choosing harmonization would have mean to enlist all works of art in all member states that were not to be exported. That was harmonization, is the creation of the notion of an European cultural interest, according to which export of works in which this interest was embodied was not permitted. And of course, that was not possible. And why wasn't that possible? Because it would have been a violation of Article 13. Remember that Article 30 enables member states to define and to protect and to limit the export of their own national treasuries. And this notion of national treasuries in Article 30 was not compatible with the creation of a European treasury notion. The other branch of the alternative was mutual recognition. But what would have been mutual recognition? Mutual recognition would have mean the enforcement by all custom authorities of the member state or of 12, letter 15, and note 25, national legislation related to the protection of their national treasures. So that was legally possible. There was no obstacle in the treaty, but that was technically impracticable. So, the third sub-point, the solution was a partial harmonization. And this partial harmonization is based on the notion of an export, common export license. How does it work? The 3911 regulation created a list of categories of works of art. And if an object, a works of art, falls into one of the categories of the list, member states must release and export a common export license when such a work of art leave the territory. So this notion of the list and its category, this is the core, this is the minimal harmonization. So it is not a list of items, it's a list of categories. For example, you have archaeological objects, paintings more than a century old, you have archives, so very broad categories that are commonly recognized by all member states. And in case of export, the member state must release an export license when the works of art falls into one of the categories. Okay, you wanted to ask something?
No, you clarified it. Thank you.
And this export license must be presented when the work of art is intended to be exported outside the Union. This regulation, number 3911, is a very complex one, and I have no time to be more precise and to make an in-depth analyze. Let's tackle the fourth and last point dedicated to the return of cultural object and to directive number 7 of the 15th of March 1983 related to the return of cultural objects unlawfully removed from the territory of a member state. I will tackle, I intended to tackle four sub-points. The third will be the legal basis for the directive, the second will be the scheme of the directive, and the third will be the main characteristics of the directive, and the fourth should have been the relationship between the directive and other international instruments, because here arises another problem related to the more broad question of the relationship between EU law and other international instruments having covering the same field. But I think we won't have the time to tackle this important issue. So let's concentrate on the three sub-points. First, the legal basis of the directive. The legal basis of the directive is no more Article 133 and the Common Commercial Policy. What the reason for that? The reason is that the nature of the mechanism provided by the directive, that is the return of illicitly removed
works of art is no more commercial. It has no more to deal with trade. It is a balance between the free movement of goods with national competencies granted by Article 30 of the treaty. And so the legal basis of the directive was Article 95. What is second sub-point, the scheme of the directive? Well, it works as follows. The member state from whose territory the object, an object, has been unlawfully removed, and this member state is called the requesting state, has the right to bring an action for its return in the court of the member state where the item has been traced. The proceeding can be brought only on the basis of a document which describes the object covered by the request and states that it is a cultural object with an accompanying declaration from the administrative authorities of the requesting state that the object has been unlawfully removed. If these requirements are substantiated, the competent court of the requested state is obliged to order the return of the object to its territory of origin. Some word about the expression unlawfully removed. That means every object removed in breach of the member state's rules on the protection of national treasures. Remember, member state rules according to the exception of Article 13. Second, in breach of regulation number 3911, or third, when an object was not returned at the end of a lawful temporary removal. And those three cases are considered unlawfully removed of a cultural good. In order to be more synthetic, I would like to present you the three main characteristics of the directive. Let's say to say what I just said, but in a more following a different approach. So the first main characteristic of the directive is the obligation of restitution, and remember this is one of the major trends in this EU legislation or international legislation related to the restitution of work of arts. And what I would like to underline that this is the end, at least amongst European member states, of the rule of private international law which forbids the enforcement of foreign public law. Remember, we talked about that 1 hour ago. According to international private law, national courts are not obliged to enforce foreign public laws. But with the directive, they now are obliged. Remember, under the directive is considered as unlawfully removed an object removed in breach of the member state's rules on the protection on national treasure. So this rule, this private international rules, is now subverted by the directive. This rule is also subverted by other international convention, it was a little bit subverted by the UNESCO Convention of 1970 we talked about, and also by other convention we have no time to speak about, unfortunately. The second main characteristic of the directive is that the principle according to which ownership of a good, and especially cultural good, can be acquired through protection in good faith is also subverted. Remember, that was a characteristic of conservative countries of southern Europe, and that was contradictory with all the public laws related to the protection of cultural heritage, that ownership, it was possible to acquire ownership of a good through possession in good faith. And the directive cancel this possibility. The third and last point I will tackle, third main characteristic of the directive, is the compensation for the possessor. And this is mainly Article 9 of the directive, that the competent court, the court which order the restitution, if condition are fulfilled. Okay, I told you about the condition that you have, that the proceedings can be brought only on the basis of a document which describes the object covered and declaration that it has been unlawfully removed. So if the condition of the directive are fulfilled, so the judge can award the possessor a compensation if the possessor can demonstrate he was in good faith at the moment he purchased the work of art. The problem is that the directive doesn't provide for the burden of the proof of the good faith and left it open to the member state. And that can create, and that had created discrepancies between member states. And last point, compensation. If a compensation is due, is paid by the requesting state, but the requesting state is has the right to recovering the amount of the compensation from the person responsible for the unlawful removal of the cultural object from its territory. Well, unfortunately, I can't go farther. I will have many other things to tell you. I thank you for your attention. This was very complex and perhaps difficult to follow. Do you have
any
questions?
Yeah.
Do you have time for questions in the remaining?
Okay. Putting in people's resistance.
Yes?
Just to clarify the last thing you had said,
yes.
The compensation is due from the country housing the offender, right? Like if an Italian work of art is in England, the person, the private owner in England,
is granted the compensation from the Italian state.
Okay. So England would have to pay Italy.
No. England has nothing to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
England is the requested state. And in case if in England the person possessing the work of art can demonstrate his good faith, compensation will be paid by Italy, and Italy will ask the responsible, the Italian, or to be reimbursed for this compensation. Okay. Yes.
Is the amount of compensation set by the
Judge
at the moment
in which the judge ordered the restitution? It also, if the condition for compensation are fulfilled, the judge also at the same moment the judge fix the amount of the compensation.
And is there are there greater implications that this seems to subvert some principles of national law, such that a national state can order another state to pay a set compensation? It seems like a sovereignty question that is getting blurred here.
No, I don't get. I don't get. No, but it's probably due to my. Can you repeat it again?
Yeah, it seems to me that this has set up a rule where a judge in the UK can make a binding decision and set the amount that comes from a public coffer of another state, France, for instance.
Uh-huh, uh-huh,
uh-huh. So, such that a judge in the UK has power over the essential sovereignty of France. Have we there been any reverberations from that?
Yeah, I will say that it's just a side effect. And it's more defending French sovereignty than attacking French sovereignty. Because according, you know, the main characteristic of the directive or the convention is to permit the automatic restitution of the object if conditions are fulfilled. So that afterwards, those kind of problems can arise, yes, but to me it's it can be important, but it's a side effect. The main important effect is to have the object back.
Okay.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.